Welcome everyone to Cornell's Equine Seminar Series. My name is Sarah Bassman and I'm the program coordinator for the series. This is the last seminar of the spring session. So we will be taking a break for the months of June, July, and August. Hopefully it'll be beautiful weather and everybody will be outside with their horses and not even thinking about being on the computer. But I just wanted to thank everybody who has attended in this spring session. We've really seen our audience grow. It's a national and international audience and equine enthusiasts at all different levels. And it's really wonderful and we're happy to have you here. So I'll just reiterate one more time, please use the chat and the question and answer box. If you have any problems, you can contact me directly. And I'd like to get us started with Dr. Katharyn Mitchell. Take it away.
Thanks, Sarah. So welcome everyone to this session here about what we do or what we worry about when our vet hears a heart murmur. So that's a problem I think that you might have faced or you might face in the future. And it's always good to know what is a heart murmur and what does that mean for you and your horse. So hopefully today we'll answer some of those questions for you. So just a little bit about me. I am from New Zealand, as you might be able to tell from my accent. So I'm a Kiwi, and I've had a bit of a journey around the world with my veterinary career. So I've worked in Australia. I've worked actually here at Cornell some years ago, and then back in Australia. And then I was lucky enough to end up in Switzerland for a few years. And now I've made my way sort of via New Zealand back to the US again. And I guess my journey where it comes to hearts and why I love the heart, which sounds a bit funny to say, is started when I was very young. So this is a picture of me here. I think I'm about 6 or 7 here in this picture, pointing out my favorite part of the human body, the heart. And that's because my mum was a nurse, and she was a critical care coronary care nurse. And she also taught first aid and CPR. And so I think I was 4 when I first learned how to do CPR, and was giving tutorials when I was 6 and 7 about the circulation and about why we need to look after our hearts. So it's been a pretty big passion of mine to understand and learn about the heart throughout my veterinary career. And I was lucky enough to spend almost 8 years in Switzerland doing a PhD, studying the equine heart and actually arrhythmias, so irregular heart rhythms of the horse. And so that brings us to this talk today. And so I'm actually trained in large animal internal medicine. That's what I did here at Cornell back in 2007 to 2010. And then I've done the cardiology training on top of that. So I did the PhD. So I'm actually here at Cornell working in large animal medicine, but I also get to see the equine and large animal cardiology cases. And I'm working on those in conjunction with our small animal cardio team, who previously were seeing the large animal cases. So if you have a problem with a horse or a cow or a sheep or a goat that has a heart problem, then when you come to Cornell, hopefully you'll get to see me and potentially even our small animal team. We might work together to be able to help solve the problem that your horse has and hopefully get it back on track. So a little bit about me and my journey around the world. And so just to start off with a few fun facts about the horse's heart. So I just moved my little screen here. So this is the horse's heart here in the chest. So you can sort of see it sits up quite cranial. If you can see my cursor, sits up quite in front of underneath the triceps and right in behind the shoulder and the elbow of the horse. And so it's sitting quite far forward, covered up by the lungs and then the rib cage. So it's pretty protected in there. And it's relatively small for the size of the horse. So it takes up about 1% of the body weight of the horse. So if your horse is 500 kilograms or about 1,100 pounds, then your heart will probably be around the 5 kilogram or 10 pound mark. And so the heart, relatively speaking, is quite small, but it does a pretty extraordinary job. And so when the horse is at rest, every time the heart beats, it pumps around a liter. So around probably, what's that? A quart, I guess. So it pumps about a liter per beat. And the horse's heart rate at rest is around 40 beats per minute. So that means that you're going to have about 40 liters of blood circulating around the body every minute. And that's what happens at rest. And then the most extraordinary thing about the horse is its capacity to increase the amount of blood that's flowing during exercise. And so at exercise, our heart rate goes up, as we know, and horses have a maximum heart rate kind of similar to humans. So we're humans max out around 220 beats per minute. The horse can usually go a little bit more than that, sort of 230. Some horses, you know, 230 is absolute maximum for their heart rate. And then when it's beating somewhere in the order of 250 liters or more around the body at peak exercise, which is a pretty extraordinary thing when you think about it. So the horse's heart is a phenomenal pump and does a pretty amazing job of circulating that blood around the body and getting the oxygen into that blood and then sending that oxygen to the tissues for it to be enabling those tissues to work maximally. So as I said, it's a pretty extraordinary pump, and the horse's heart is made up of two sides. So we have the right side of the heart and the left side of the heart. And then we're, each side has two small chambers. So we have a left atrium or a right atrium. They're like reservoirs, basically. So that's where some blood is stored. And then there are two bottom chambers, so the ventricles. And they're the left ventricle and the right ventricle, they're the pumps. And so they really do the job of pumping that blood around either to the lungs or to the body, depending on what side of the heart we're talking about. And so if we're thinking about the right side of the heart, that's taking the blood or collecting the blood from the body. So it's been out into the body, it's done its, you know, it's been out to the liver and the kidneys and the brain, and it's coming back now into the heart to go again. And so it enters the right atrium, goes down into the right ventricle, and the right ventricle pumps that blood into the lungs. And that's where all the oxygen is basically sitting in the lungs. So you're breathing in that oxygen, it's sitting in the lungs, and then the blood gets all filled with oxygen, and then it comes back into the left side. So it comes back into the left atrium, the little reservoir, and then it goes into the left ventricle, that's the big pump, and he pumps the blood all the way out the body into the aorta, and then that goes around the body to your brain, to your lungs, to your kidneys, to your muscles, and that's, you know, that's where we get the oxygen delivered to our tissues from. And so when we think about that, that's a, you know, pretty complex system that has to work in has to work simultaneously. So the right side and the left side have to work together, and to get the blood from the body to the lungs, and then from the lungs back out into the body again. And so that's how the horse's heart works. And so between each of the chambers, so between the atrium and the ventricle, there's a valve that stops the blood from going backwards. So on the right side of the heart, that's called the tricuspid valve. And on the left side of the heart, that's called the mitral valve. And then in the big blood vessels, so the blood vessels going to the lungs or the blood vessels going to the body, there are also heart valves. So if we're in the aorta, that's the aortic valve. And if we're in the pulmonary artery, that's the artery that goes to the lungs, we have the pulmonary valve. And they also stop the blood from going backwards. So the idea is that the blood is always moving forward, and you don't have blood going backwards. Because if you start to have blood going backwards, you end up in some trouble, just like with any kind of pump. So how does the heart get the idea that it needs to squeeze? That's a, you know, a pretty important part of the whole system of the pump working. And basically the signals come, they're electrical signals, and they tell the heart muscle to squeeze. And so when we see that, we see that there's a little piece of tissue up here. It's called the sinus node. He's basically the guy who makes the signals. And then the signals travel across the atrium. And then they get to a fellow called the AV node. I don't know why I call him a fellow, but maybe he's a girl. But the AV node. And I think of the AV node kind of like a person with the stop-go sign where you see, when you see construction on the road. And so the AV node is kind of deciding whether he sends the signals down to the ventricles or whether he stops the signal. And in the horse, the AV node does sometimes stop the signal just naturally because the horse is kind of a relaxed fellow at rest. But in general, that electrical signal goes from the sinus node across the atria to the AV node, who decides whether the signal passes down to the ventricles. And then once the tissue gets that signal, then the tissue contracts. And so that's, you know, that's a really important part of the whole system, is getting that electrical signal and then the muscle responding to that appropriately. And so when that electrical signal goes haywire, that's when we get an arrhythmia. So that's when we get an irregular heart rhythm. So we either get not enough beats, or we get too many beats, or we get the beats all mixed up, and we get fast beats and slow beats, and kind of everything is not so coordinated anymore. And then the squeezing is affected, of course. And so I think that it's a really important to understand that the electrical signals tell the heart what to do, and then the heart squeezes and then pumps that blood around the body, either to the lungs or to the rest of the body. And I just have a couple of nice pictures here that show the spreading of the electrical signal. So the top is the electrical signal spreading across the atrium. So you can see the color change from purple to red as that electrical signal spreads. And then the bottom is that electrical signal spreading throughout the ventricle. And again, you can see that happens. It's pretty amazing how quick that electrical signal spreads and then tells the heart muscle to squeeze, and then the heart muscle squeezes from there. And these beautiful videos of that are produced by some of my colleagues in Belgium. They work at the University of Ghent, and they have been able to map these electrical signals and how they travel across the heart as a way of understanding what's going on. And then also, if we have irregular heartbeats, potentially being able to treat those by identifying whereabouts they're happening and then being able to do something about that. So that's a pretty exciting technology that's very new, and we're hoping to be able to bring this technology here to Cornell in the near future.
Dr. Mitchell, if I can interrupt you quickly, we are seeing a few black boxes over your presentation that might be your Zoom controls.
Yes. Good point. Let me see if I can hide them. Nope, that hid me. That was good. Let me see, hide them. Is that better? Can you see less black boxes?
Oh, there was just one less. Now we're seeing two. Now we're seeing one. Okay.
Oh, good. Now then, how do I get
so rid of sorry me? For the interruption.
No, you're fine. I'm just trying to figure out how I get me back. So how do I get rid of me? As always. Now I've gone and hid them. Let me see. Now they've come back.
At the top of the video of yourself.
Okay, so now we're hidden. Is everything gone now?
There's still one bar in the middle. Oh, now, there.
Now it's gone?
That's it.
Okay. Okay. Super. Okay.
Thank you so much.
No worries. I didn't even notice they were sitting there. So thanks for letting me know. All right. So how do we know if there is a heart problem going on in your horse? And I think that there are a few things when we're talking with you where there might be some, you know, what I call ding ding bells, where we might start to think, gosh, is the heart fine in this horse, or is there a problem with the heart? And there are certainly some breeds where I have those ding ding bells ring pretty loud, because we know certain breeds have predispositions to heart problems. In particular, I'm thinking about Arabs and I'm thinking about Frisians. They're the two that would have the biggest or the loudest ding ding bells for me. But also I'm thinking about Welsh ponies. I'm thinking about just ponies in general. But I'm also thinking about those thoroughbreds and those standardbreds, those racehorses, where I know that if they are exercising to a certain level, their heart's going to be adapting to that exercise. And as the heart adapts, there can be some changes that happen that can create some heart murmurs. So there could be some, you know, some heart murmurs where I hear them and I think, oh, that's just because this is a highly trained, really fit athletic horse, and it's not really something to worry about. And so I'm going to be asking these kind of questions when we're chatting about your horse. It's also really helpful to know when the last time your horse was normal. So when did this problem arise? Has your vet always said that there was a heart murmur, even from when it was a little foal? Or is this something where your vet never heard anything wrong before, and then now all of a sudden, as he's got older, there's been a new finding? And so figuring out how long the problem has been going on for can be really helpful to understand what is happening and what's the reason behind the heart murmur. And then if we're looking at whether there's a problem with your horse and we're trying to figure out is the heart the cause of the problem, we're going to be asking questions about how much energy does the horse have, how does the horse recover after exercise, has there been a change in the performance, so has the horse gone from performing at a certain level and now the horse can't do that same job anymore without getting puffed or without getting tired or feeling a little bit wobbly, and has there been any weight loss? So especially in our older horses where if their heart disease is getting important, they can certainly start to lose some weight and they can develop a cough. And it's not uncommon for the cough to be thought of as having maybe a primary respiratory problem, so some equine asthma, for example, but actually underlying it, there is a heart problem. And so the cough and then hearing a heart murmur at the same time might be an important finding. And if you're talking about young animals, we might see them that they don't grow as well as their herd mates. We might see that they don't keep up with their pasture mates, so that if they're all galloping around, there's one lagging behind that is, you know, maybe having trouble breathing or feels a little bit weak or wobbly. And so that can be another sign that there's something there that you need to investigate and look into further. But it's also important to recognize, now my mouse doesn't work. Excellent. There we go. That many horses can have very normal performance despite quite impressive heart disease. And so it takes a lot for a horse's heart to impede its performance. There's a huge capacity, a reserve capacity in the horse's heart because we bred them to be athletes. And so they can do quite extraordinary things with impressive heart disease. And so just because we find something wrong with your horse's heart doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to have a problem with its performance. But as you'll see, there's some specific reasons or situations where we start to worry about it, especially safety. If you have a heart problem and depending on what your horse does as a job, there may be a safety implication. So how do I know that there's a problem? I think it really comes down to doing a thorough physical exam, which of course, you know, your vet's going to be doing when he or she is out on the farm looking at your horse. And I think for you as owners, the single most important thing is to give that vet the best opportunity to hear things that are wrong. So having a quiet environment where there's no wind blowing, nobody's on the leaf blower, nobody's hosing down or sweeping, where the horse is standing really still and nobody's talking, the dog's not yapping, and that will give you the best chance of having your vet hear if there's a problem, because it can be really challenging. I've spent a lot of time working in Australia in the field, and we never had sheds or barns, and so we're out there in the windy paddocks, and you know, it was really challenging sometimes to hear the heart, not let alone figure out if there was a problem with the heart. And so I think giving your vet the best opportunity to hear if there's a problem. Of course, the body condition of the horse can also be a big issue. So if you've got a little excess condition on your horse, it can be really hard to hear the heart because it's a little bit muffled by all of that extra padding or fat, as we should say. So skinnier horses, definitely it's easier to hear the heart compared to horses that are a little bit over-conditioned. And just as a reminder, it's always, always, always important to listen to both sides of the heart. So if you don't see your vet going around and listening to that right side of the heart, just give them a little prod and be like, hey, did you listen to the right side of the heart? I know it's really important because things can happen on one side of the heart or the other that can tell you different problems. And nobody wants to miss a problem by just not listening to the right side of the heart. It's also important to, you know, look at subtle things that might change with your horse. So as I said before, any weight loss, any muscle loss, any increase in breathing rate or coughing, any development of if the jugulars start to stick out and you can see the jugular veins all of a sudden, or if they have like a pulse in them, or if there's any edema, so swelling under the skin that's sort of fluidy, that might be between the under the chest or under the abdomen or even in the limbs, so on the legs. So if you see any of these kind of signs, or your horse is all of a sudden out of energy and just wants to laze around all the time, these might be subtle signs that there's a problem with the heart and you should get it checked out. So when we're listening to the heart, what is normal to hear? And so we have some normal heart sounds that we hear when we are listening to the heart. And so normally we're hearing this lubbed up, lubbed up, lubbed up, lubbed up. And so what makes those normal sounds that we're hearing? And so if we think about the lub, the first heart sound, then it's the closing of those big valves, the mitral valve on the left side and the tricuspid valve on the right side. And when those valves close, they make a little bit of noise. And so that would make you have the lub. And then what causes the dup? That's going to be the closing of those smaller valves that are in those blood vessels. So the pulmonary valve and the aortic valve, when they close, they're going to make a dup. And so that when you hear those normal sounds, you know that the heart is, you know, closing those valves as they should do. There are a couple of other heart sounds that can be normal to hear, but you don't hear in every horse. And that would be the blub dup, blub dup. So the little buh there at the front, and that's a filling noise. And then sometimes we'll also hear what we would be a lub dup da, and that little duh there at the end, that's a filling noise. So sometimes you actually hear the blood filling in the heart, and that can be completely normal. And so if you're, you know, that's just to explain a little bit about what we normally hear. And just to point out on those pictures here, if we're looking at this, this is the a heart looking down from above. So like you're riding the horse and you're looking down on the heart. So the horse's head is going to be up here and the horse's tail is going to be down here. And then the left side of the horse is over here and the right side of the horse is over here. And so we can see this big valve down the back here. This is the mitral valve. He's on the left side, even though he's kind of more just straight back. And then this is the tricuspid valve here. He's really on the right side of the horse. And then if we're looking at this guy, this is the pulmonary valve. He's really far forward on the left side. And then the aorta is really smack bang in the middle of the heart. So when you have a problem with the aortic valve, you might hear it from both sides potentially. And so that's just to explain a little bit about what we would normally hear. So when we hear abnormal things, we have to think about what causes that abnormal noise. And usually it's turbulent blood flow. So if we think about, you know, watering our garden with a hose, and when we turn that hose on and we don't have any nozzle or sprayer or anything, the water just flows out of that hose. It doesn't really make a loud noise. We can hear it, but we don't hear a loud noise. But if we put a nozzle on, or we put our finger over the end of the hose, then we start to restrict the flow of blood and we get turbulent. Or water, I guess, we get turbulent flow of that water and we start to hear that, it gets louder. And so when we have turbulent flow, we can hear that as an abnormal noise. The other analogy to think about is when you're listening to a river, and if you're beside the river and it's really calm and flat, you won't really hear the river at all. But once you get to some rapids or a waterfall and you start to get some turbulent flow in that water, you start to be able to hear it. And so that's basically what's happening in the heart, is if you get turbulent blood flow, you're going to start to hear it. And so what makes that turbulent blood flow is if those valves are not working. So if those valves start to leak. And so if we think about what might happen between the lub and the dup, and if those mitral or tricuspid valves are leaking, then we might hear a murmur that would sound like a lub sh dub, lub sh dub, lub sh dub. So we might hear the sh, which is the turbulent blood flow. And if we hear it between those lub and the dub, then we're going to know that which valves are leaking. So it's either the mitral valve or the tricuspid valve has developed a leak for some reason, and now we can hear that turbulent blood flow. If we think about what might happen after the dub and before the next lub, then this would be lub dub, lub dub, lub dub. That's what we call a diastolic murmur. And so this is going to be leaking of those either aortic valve or pulmonary valve that should be closed, but now are leaking and the blood flow is turbulent. And usually the blood flow is going backwards in the wrong direction. And so that's what makes the heart murmur, is turbulent blood flow within the heart. And usually in the horse, that's because one of these valves is leaking. And usually the valves leak because there's some damage to the valve. Sometimes it's degeneration of the valve. So the valve's just got worn out because it's been doing the job for a long time. And it's just like, you know, joints and other things, they kind of get worn out. And so heart valves can wear out as well. But sometimes we have infections or we have inflammation of the valves where we can, you know, have more, you know, an acute problem in a younger animal as well. And it's also important to remember that murmurs are pretty common to hear. And so depending on the population of horses we're looking at, we can hear usually about 1 in 5 horses will have a murmur. But if we're talking about really fit racehorses, for example, so gallopers or trotters or eventers, we might hear even up as high as 4 out of 5 horses having a murmur. But there's specific kinds of murmurs that we know are more common with training and fitness. And there are other murmurs where we know that should just not be happening in this type of horse. And so I think that there, you know, when we're listening, we can kind of try and tell whether or not this is a problem that we expect to hear, or if this is something important that we need to do something about. When we grade murmurs, we basically are trying to figure out so we can tell one another how loud they are. So we have a grading system. And so it's based on whether or not you can feel a vibration against your hand, which is called a thrill, and whether or not you can hear the abnormal noises louder or quieter than the normal heart sounds. And so as just a general rule, you obviously don't need to learn this grading system, but just to understand that if it's an obvious murmur that you can, you know, people hear where as soon as they listen to your horse's heart, then that's probably going to be a grade 3 or more. So that's kind of what I call like the student cutoff. So if the students hear it and everybody hears it, it's really obvious, that usually makes it a grade 3. The quieter murmurs, they really need to be, you need to be right over the spot and everybody needs to be quiet and the horse has to stand perfectly still. And then you might be able to hear those quieter murmurs. But if it's obvious, you put that, you know, somebody puts a stethoscope on the chest and you can hear it straight away, then it's at least a grade 3, if not louder. And once you start to feel it on your hand, then that makes it a grade 5. And I've definitely had horses where I haven't needed my stethoscope and you could just feel that they have a murmur from the paddock or from across the stall, or when you're listening to the lungs or the gut sounds or whatever. And so that would be a grade 6. So that's just how we grade the murmurs, just so that we can track them over time and then also talk about them and record them so that other people know how loud it is. We have this kind of set grading system. So as I said before, the common things that happen in the horse's heart, it's a little bit more simple in the horse compared to maybe small animals or people. There's a few less common things. So that's always helpful for us as equine vets and as owners of horses. It's a bit more straightforward. But if you're listening on the left side of the horse and you hear a systolic murmur, so between the lub and the dub, so that lub, sh, dub, that's going to usually be the mitral valve leaking. And so that's this guy down the back here. You're going to hear him loudest on the left side. If you're on the right side of the horse, then usually it's going to be the tricuspid valve that's leaking. But occasionally we see the situation where we actually have something that the horse was born with a defect in its heart, which would be a defect usually between the two ventricles. So between the two big chambers, that'd be called a ventricular septal defect or a VSD. You might've heard of that term. And that would cause a murmur that was loudest on the right, but also you would hear pretty much everywhere. So you'd hear it on the left side as well, but it would be usually quieter. Now you might've heard your vet talk about physiologic heart murmurs and or flow murmurs. And so these are murmurs that are made from the blood being ejected out of the heart, either going to the lungs or going out to the body. So it's the blood flow in the aorta or the pulmonary vessels. And that can sometimes, especially in younger horses, when it's, you know, ejected with a lot of force, it can make a little bit of turbulence. And so that's what we call a flow murmur. But these are very quiet murmurs and they're very far forward on the heart. So they have very specific requirements to be called a flow murmur. And if you're hearing anything that's obvious and that is, a louder murmur, then it's not going to be a flow murmur in most situations. And so I think a lot of horses probably have been called with a physiologic heart murmur, especially say if your horse has had colic and the vet might have heard a murmur, and then when the horse is not colicky at all, then the murmur is not present. And people will call these physiologic murmurs, but these are probably leaking valves, but they just leak at a really, you know, low level. And when the horse was stressed or dehydrated or, you know, painful or whatever, then that leak got a little bit louder. And then once the colic resolved or the fever resolved or whatever, then that leak gets quieter again and it's just harder to hear. So I think most horses probably don't have physiologic murmurs unless they're really young horses, but most of them probably just have very small leaks that get a little bit worse when they are having some kind of problem like a colic episode. So when we're talking about the diastolic murmurs, so these are the murmurs, we have the lub, dub, shoo, lub dub shoo. These are usually pretty musical murmurs and pretty impressive loud murmurs, but not always. And these are usually murmurs of the aortic valve leaking. So this guy right here in the middle of the heart. So when he leaks, that makes you have these really pretty spectacular diastolic murmurs. And you can hear them from both sides of the chest. So from the left and from the right. This guy up here, the pulmonary valve, he sometimes leaks, but it's really quiet. And so it's usually very hard to hear if he's leaking. So I think most of the time, if we hear a diastolic murmur, it's going to be an aortic valve until we prove otherwise. Now, you might have heard that, you know, of horses that rupture their aorta. And sometimes when horses drop dead during exercise, you know, people will say, oh, it probably ruptured its aorta. And that's certainly, you know, true that horses can rupture their aorta. And if they rupture it outside of their heart, so in their chest or in their body, in their abdomen, then they can bleed out very quickly. But they can also rupture their aorta inside the heart. And so here at the base of the aorta, where the vessel is joined onto the heart, it can rupture. And you can actually have the blood going back around. So it can rupture inside the heart, into one of the ventricles, or into the pulmonary artery, or into the atrium. It can do all sorts of things, or into the pericardium, so the sac around the heart. And these are called aortic cardiac fistula, or if it's into the pulmonary, it's aortic pulmonary fistula. That's a Frisian thing to do. And these would be horses that have acute colic, but you can't really find anything wrong with them. They're passing manure, but they seem really agitated and sweaty and anxious and painful. And the pain medication doesn't really help them a lot. And the vet would hear a loud murmur and sometimes an irregular heartbeat. And this could be, you know, a situation where the horse could be rupturing its aorta, but without, you know, outside of the heart, so that the blood keeps going around inside there. So it's definitely a big dangerous situation. It doesn't happen very often, but we do see, you know, two or three of these every year. And it's just something to keep in mind that if everything is, you know, your horse seems really unhappy and the vet hears a new murmur that could be both a systole and a diastole. So it sort of sounds like a washing machine, like a kind of a murmur that would be on the right side, then that would be a situation where we definitely want to look at the aorta and see what was going on there. And then there's also the situation where sometimes, especially in young horses, when the blood rapidly fills into the heart, it can make a little bit of a squeaking sound. So it can sound like a eek, kind of a eek noise, which is a squeaking sound. And that's a perfectly normal noise for the heart to make. And that just tells you that the filling of the heart, that blood coming into the heart, is happening in a little bit of a rapid way. So sometimes you can hear some quite unusual noises in the heart and they can be perfectly normal too. So what does this mean for the heart? So if we have a heart murmur, what does this then mean? And so if we think about the mitral valve and having a leaking mitral valve, or mitral valve regurgitation or insufficiency, these are all the same kind of words. We think about, this is the mitral valve here, and here's our left atrium, that small chamber, and then here's our left ventricle, that big pumping chamber. And so if this valve is leaking here, then the blood is going to go backwards into the atrium, and it's going to increase the pressure and also eventually enlarge the atrium, because there's more blood in there than there should be. And so that's what we're most worried about, is if that atrium becomes enlarged with time, because the larger it gets, the more chance you have of it getting an arrhythmia. Because when you have a lot of tissue under a lot of pressure, that can, you know, predispose to irregular heartbeats. So that would potentially cause arrhythmias. And when we're thinking about that, the most common one we're thinking about is atrial fibrillation, which you might have heard of. And we can do a whole nother session on arrhythmias. But what we're worried about here is if that atrium gets big with time, and then we have the risk of developing an arrhythmia. It's far, far, far less common for that atrium to be so big that then the pressure goes back into the lungs and the heart fails, and then you could get pulmonary edema. So that would be a much more uncommon situation, but certainly we see, you know, one or two of those every year, but it's not something we see every week by any stretch. So just a couple of examples so you know what that looks like. So this is a couple of ultrasound images of our horses. These were horses that were having their murmurs evaluated. They'd been heard on pre-purchase exam. So both of these were pre-purchase exam ultrasounds. And the murmurs were fairly similar. The horse on the left had a little bit of a quieter murmur than the horse on the right. But what you'll see is when we're looking at this with the ultrasound, we can see the blood flow that's turbulent, that's going backwards, it's color-coded in green. And so when I play this video, you can see that there are a couple of jets of green going backwards into the left atrium. So here, the kind of guy who looks like a parachute, that's the valve. And then this is the left atrium here. And you can see these couple of jets of green going backwards into this left atrium. So the left atrium is not big at this point in time. It's okay in size. And the horse has got a regular heart rhythm. And so this is the sort of thing where we would say, okay, the horse is doing fine for right now, but we need to watch this and see what happens over some time, probably some years. And eventually this horse might get a bigger left atrium, but this might just stay really stable as well. And we just need to some time to see that. Whereas we contrast that to the horse on the right here, and we play the video, we'll see if it plays, here we go. So here we have a lot of green. We can see a couple of really big jets of green, almost kind of swirling around, we can see that. And this left atrium is enlarged. It's a really pretty big left atrium at this point. And we can also notice that the rhythm is not regular. So we have an irregular rhythm. And this is actually a horse that has gone into atrial fibrillation because of how big its atrium has got. And so this was actually, these horses were both competing show jumpers and both without any, you know, signs from the outside that there was a problem. But the horse from on the right is definitely, you know, going to progress faster, is not going to be a great candidate for purchase, for sale or for purchase. And potentially she's only young. So these horses were 4 or 5 years old. And the horse on the right is actually, when we exercised her, is having really fast heartbeats happening during exercise. So her heart rate was getting up over 300 when we were just lunging her at the canter. And so you're not going to feel very great doing that for very long periods of time, and certainly has some safety considerations there that we wouldn't feel safe with anybody riding a horse like that, because we'd be worried about it having a collapse potentially, and that could be very dangerous for the rider. So just a couple of examples there of what the ultrasound looks like, and pretty similar situations, but different outcomes and different recommendations for those two horses. So then let's change tack and think about the aortic valve, when the aortic valve leaks. So when we have aortic regurgitation or insufficiency. And so this is the aortic valve here. So between the aorta and the left ventricle. And so when the aortic valve leaks, that blood is going to go backwards into that left ventricle. And over time, that means the left ventricle is going to become enlarged. And that in itself is a problem. And then if it becomes so enlarged, then sometimes it will actually stretch the mitral valve, and the mitral valve will start leaking. And then you can get a big left atrium as well. And so this can be, you know, kind of a more serious situation, because you can end up with a couple of different problems. And we worry about the left ventricle becoming enlarged, because again, if it's enlarged, we can get arrhythmias. And it's the arrhythmias that come from the ventricle that we are most concerned about from a safety point of view. And we definitely, you know, worry about these horses having collapse or even sudden death when they're being exercised. And so that's the reason why we're wanting to see how big the ventricle is, and see how much hypertrophy there is of that heart muscle, and then also looking for secondary problems like stretching of this mitral valve, and then becoming, you know, also developing mitral regurgitation as well. So a leaking mitral valve as a secondary thing, which can then, similar to what we just saw, develop arrhythmias that come from the atria as well. And so here's a couple more examples of what that looks like. So in these pictures, we have the horse's heart with the aortic valve here in the middle. So the aorta is pointing off to the right, and then the left ventricle is out here on the left. And in this first example, we can see the green is that aortic valve leaking, and this is a mild amount of leaking. We can see that the ventricle is working. It's doing a good job squeezing. It's not too big at this point in time. And so everything looks pretty stable, and we would, you know, be pretty optimistic that this horse would be able to do its job and not have too many concerns, at least for a good period of time. But if we look at the horse that's on the right here, we can see that there's a lot of green going on here. So this is now what we call severe regurgitation or leaking. And this horse has got a big heart. You can kind of see how hard it's working. So you can really see that heart kind of squeezing, moving really hard to try and deal with all the extra blood that's coming backwards into that ventricle. And this is a horse where we would be quite worried about because the heart muscle was actually kind of thickened and the heart's working really hard. It's probably not getting a great amount of oxygen to the tissues of the heart. And so that can create some arrhythmia concerns. And so this was actually a school horse. He was used for riding lessons and ridden by children. And when we saw this degree of leaking of this aortic valve and how big his heart had got and how hard his heart was having to work, we were pretty concerned about him. And so we had said we should retire him from being a schoolmaster and being ridden by children. And he should just live out his days. He was in his 20s, live out his days and be a pasture ornament. And unfortunately, 10 days after we did this exam, he actually was just galloping in the field and had probably an arrhythmia, an irregular heart rhythm, and he just collapsed and died suddenly. And so I was really grateful that the kids were not on him when that happened, because that was a pretty scary thing for it to happen. And I'm very glad that nobody other than him, you know, obviously is really sad for him, but nobody got hurt when he did collapse and die. Okay, so on that, let's move to a slightly happier note. So tricuspid regurgitation or leaking of that tricuspid valve, the valve that's on the right side of the heart, this is something that we see a lot, and depending on the type of horse, we worry less about or more about. So this is the valve that would leak most commonly with training. So as the horse's heart gets bigger with training, we'll see that valve starting to leak, and we'll start to hear that murmur. And so if I'm looking at a galloper or a trotter or an eventer, and I'm hearing a tricuspid valve regurgitation, I'm not going to be as worried about that as if I'm listening to maybe a low-level performance horse, a pleasure horse, or a pasture horse, where if I hear that murmur, I'm going to be thinking, you're not really fit enough to have had the changes to your heart that would make this murmur. So maybe there's something else going on. And in particular, thinking about something else going on in the lungs, because that right heart is having to pump the blood through the lungs. And if there's something going on with the lungs, it makes it harder for that right heart to pump through the lungs. And so you can end up with that right heart starting to feel a little bit unhappy. And so if we have any evidence of respiratory problems, a cough, or any kind of history of asthma or anything like that, then we're going to start to think, oh, is this because of another problem versus is this just the heart itself? But there's certainly, you know, most of the time the tricuspid valve leaking is pretty well tolerated. The right atrium will get a little bit big with time if the tricuspid valve leaks a lot, and that can lead to atrial fibrillation as well, similar to what we saw with the mitral valve. And so we do watch out for that, particularly in those horses where the right heart does get big. They can definitely develop arrhythmias as well. But for the most part, the right heart's a little bit more tolerant, and we are usually less worried about things that we hear on the right side if we think it's the tricuspid valve that's involved. It's a little bit different if we think that they have a ventricular septal defect. So that's the hole in the heart that they might be born with. So if they're usually pretty loud murmurs though, and as I said earlier, you can hear them from both sides of the heart, but they're loudest on the right usually. And so these have some particularly important consequences in some horses. And so again, these are two horses that presented for, again, pre-purchase exam evaluations. So these were horses where the murmur was heard on the pre-purchase exam, and then it was recommended that they get an ultrasound to see what was going on. And the horse on the left was a young horse. He's a three-year-old, supposed to be, I think he's supposed to be a dressage horse, actually, is a warm blood. And he was up for sale. And if I play the video here, you can see that there's a lot of green going from the left side of the heart, which is here. Up here, there's a bit of a hole you can see, and then it goes over here into the right side of the heart. So this is a pretty big hole in the heart that we can see. You can kind of tell from how much green there is. And so this is a ventricular septal defect in the typical location. And this is a big one. So this is a big hole. And this is only a three-year-old horse, but his heart is starting to feel the consequences of this. So his heart is big, his heart is working too hard, and actually his heart is having arrhythmia because of how big it's got. And so he was not really safe, even at 3 years of age. He was not safe to be ridden because of the amount of arrhythmia he had. And he was certainly on his way to developing heart failure at a really young age because of how big this hole was that he was born with. And so, of course, not a good horse to want to buy, not a good horse to be able to sell. And you're all together in a pretty sticky situation if you have this kind of a problem. And if we contrast that with the horse on the right, she has a similar kind of hole in the same location, but she has a much smaller hole. So you can see that there's still some green going between the left side of her heart and the right side of her heart, but she's got a much smaller hole. And this is actually a funny story because we saw this horse three times in the time that I was in Switzerland in 8 years, and she was sold three times. And every time she was sold, the new owners heard the heart, but had the vet out and had an exam done to give her some vaccines and things, and they heard the murmur that wasn't disclosed at the time of sale, and then brought her in to see, you know, what the cause of the murmur was. And we actually saw this horse three times over 8 years with different owners, and she was performing fine. She didn't have any problems with her heart. Her heart was normal in its size and its function. And so this was a situation where she had a small hole in her heart, and she was not affected by it at all. And I think there's probably another reason why they were constantly selling her and having her have a purchase exam or a post-purchase exam. Sometimes I talk about post-purchase regret, where people don't get a pre-purchase exam done and then wish they had, because something gets found in the shortly after they pay the money and own the horse. So I definitely am a big fan of having your horses checked out before you pay the money and buy the horse, because you want to avoid post-purchase regret if you can. So just a quick word about heart murmurs and foals. It's normal for foals to have a heart murmur when they're born, because they have a couple of things that were useful for when they were in utero. And then once they're born, they have to kind of change how the heart and the lungs work together. And so some of those channels can take a little bit of time to close, but they will close over time. And so normal foals will have a murmur when they're really little. And as soon as they are a couple of weeks old, you shouldn't be able to hear those murmurs anymore, and they should get quieter as those days go before those holes close, and then they are basically like an adult. And so if you have a foal that has a murmur and is not acting normal, so is having trouble breathing, is kind of not quite right, is not bright, is not vigorous, is not up nursing, I mean, that's abnormal in itself. But if you have a loud heart murmur and you have a foal that's not acting normal, then that can be something that definitely needs evaluating. And then if you have a murmur that doesn't go away as the foal gets older, so if it's older than 2 weeks of age and you can still hear the murmur, that's abnormal and definitely needs evaluating. And because you want to be able to pick up problems early on in the piece. And so if your vets are having a good listen to your foals when they're born, it's something for them to be paying attention to, and then, you know, just checking in on to make sure that the murmurs go away. And I pay a lot of attention in particular, as I said before, to Arabs, because we know they can have some congenital defects that can be pretty wild, and those foals can do pretty poorly when they're born, and you don't want to be treating a foal for pneumonia and find out actually it was its heart later on down the track. But I also pay attention in the Welshies and also in the Frisians, because they can have some congenital defects too. But any foal really could get a congenital abnormality that could make it have a pretty loud heart murmur that might need attention and evaluation. So just a couple of words there of when to worry about that. So why do we get our horse's heart checked out? We want to know how big it is. We want to know if it's, we always say, right, that the horse's heart, the bigger the heart, the better. And that's true to a point, but at some point the heart gets too big and that can become a problem. And so we want your horse to have a nice fit heart and a nice, you know, athletic heart, but we don't want your horse's heart to become so big that it causes us to have problems. In particular, we don't want it to cause arrhythmias. We want to know if there's any structural issues. So if we have any degenerative changes, if we have any of these, you know, congenital problems like holes in the heart, for example, we want to know how good the function is, because if the heart function is starting to deteriorate, we need to maybe think about some therapy for that. And we want to know if there's any of these irregular heart rhythms, if we have any arrhythmias happening, because they're our biggest concern, particularly from a safety standpoint, but also from a performance standpoint. And we're trying to answer these questions about safety. Is it safe for you to ride the horse? Is it safe for you to handle the horse? Is it safe for the horse to have sedation for its dental or for its wound repair? Is it safe for it to have anesthesia if it needs colic surgery? Those kind of questions. So we often need to understand if it's safe. But we also might have a horse that's not performing to expectation or has had a change in performance. And we want to know, we hear something wrong with the heart. Is that probably the cause of its performance, or is it more likely lame? To be fair, let's go with the obvious things that happen. Probably it's lame, but it could be its heart. So it's worth checking out. And we also want to try and predict, we need a crystal ball. We want to try and predict the future. And we want to know how long is this going to be, you know, before it's a problem? Have we got months? Have we got years? Have we got many years before this is going to be a problem? And so sometimes we can't tell that on a single exam, but we can check that horse over time, and we can see if it's really stable, then we think we've got a lot longer. If it's rapidly changing, then we have a little bit less time. And then often we're asked about the suitability either to sell a horse or to buy a horse, or should I have bought a horse? And so a lot of the questions we have are also about suitability for sale. And so understanding what's going on with the heart, if you hear something wrong, can be really helpful there. So if you bring your horse here for us to have a look at its heart, what's going to happen? What's the usual visit entail? And so we're going to have a really thorough exam of your horse. We're going to listen really closely to both sides of the chest. We're going to feel the pulses, going to look for any signs of weight loss or how the lungs are. Are there any edemas? We're going to really go over your horse and look at it in a lot of detail. We're going to definitely want to do an EKG or ECG. So we're going to look at the rhythm of the heart. And then we're going to usually want to look at the heart with ultrasound. So what we call an echo or echocardiography, where we're basically going to look at all of those chambers and all of the vessels and all of the valves. And we're going to see if they look appropriate, if they're normal size, if they have good function. And that usually takes about an hour by the time we do all of that. And then even longer when I do all the measurements. But the actual exam, the heart ultrasound, is usually about an hour long. And we're also going to be measuring blood pressure, because like humans, blood pressure can be really helpful in telling us what's happening with the heart. So we use the tail when we measure the blood pressure. We use a human cuff, but we put it on the tail instead of the arm. So that's something that we can also do. And there's a good chance that we might want you to exercise the horse, or we might exercise the horse and have the EKG or ECG on the horse at the same time, especially if there's a question about safety, somebody's riding this horse, what's happening during exercise. So that's definitely something we do a lot. And we do occasionally do the EKG overnight, so we get a longer period of recording, because it can be some things don't show up on a short recording, and then we really need a longer period of time to be able to see what's happening with the rhythm and if the rhythm is changing. Sometimes different things happen in the middle of the night. For example, I had a little donkey last week and she was collapsing in the middle of the night, and you could see that on the EKG because her heart rhythm was getting really, really slow. And sometimes we'll do some blood work where we look at things like the heart muscle enzymes, so what we call troponin, but also looking at things like the kidneys, because if the heart's not doing a good job, then the kidneys are going to start to suffer, for example. So we might be looking at doing some blood work as well. And so all of that will usually be something that we do within a day, depending if we need to do the overnight ECG, we might keep them a little bit longer. But usually you might come in the morning and then you'll spend a few hours with us while we get all of these tests done. And then hopefully most of the horses will be able to go home in the early to mid afternoon and then wait for us to finish all the measurements and get all the report written and get our final assessment of what's going on. So that would be the standard during a visit here. So when it comes to the horses having some heart disease, what can we do about it? And that's where it gets a little bit trickier, because unlike people or small animals, so cats and dogs, horses are huge, right? They're 500, 600 kilograms usually. And that can mean that it can be quite expensive to give them medication that is meant for people or small animals. And it can sometimes be a lot of tablets that we have to give them because of their size. And so it gets a little bit tricky when we are trying to treat heart disease in the horse. But we do have a few options. So we have some options to slow down the disease progression. session so that we can buy them some more time. And sometimes that can be years, you know, sometimes it can be months. It just depends on the horse and the problem. And we do that through drugs called ACE inhibitors primarily. So that might be something you actually hear about on the news, not on the news, but like on the ads on TV, sometimes you hear, or if you've had a dog that's had heart disease, or if you're a person maybe taking some heart medications. So ACE inhibitors are pretty commonly used, and they can try and slow down the progression of disease. If we've got arrhythmias, so irregular heart rhythms, then there's certainly some things that we can do about some of those rhythms, but not about all of them. So in particular, atrial fibrillation, that's a whole talk in itself, treating atrial fibrillation. But we have some treatment options for that. And if your horse is having a lot of premature beats, so early beats, then there are some things that we can try to some medication we can give them to try and help them out. And certainly if you've got a ventricular arrhythmia, that's something more concerning. So we are definitely usually going to hospitalize your horse and you know, treat that horse with some usually IV medication as well as some oral medication. It's a little bit different for us if the heart fails, which doesn't happen very often, fortunately for us and for the horse, but it can happen. This is the difference, I think, between the Cavalier King Charles and the Thoroughbred, where we bred the Thoroughbred for performance and the Cavalier King Charles was bred to look cute, and they didn't think about the heart. So we certainly have more trouble treating heart failure in the horse compared to in small animals and in people, mostly because they're at a pretty end stage by the time we recognize it, and there's not a lot we can do once the heart starts to decompensate and kind of shut down. But we can try to get the fluid off them with diuretics that make them pee and get rid of the fluid. Again, we use those ACE inhibitors, and then we can sometimes give drugs that actually improve the squeezing of the heart. But these are usually just to buy some time, and sometimes it's days, sometimes it's weeks, but it's not usually months and months that we can buy them time, unfortunately. So it's a little bit tricky, and it's pretty expensive if we start treating heart failure. Hopefully we'll have some more drugs that we could try here, but until they get a little bit cheaper for us, it is quite challenging for this to happen. And so just finally to something that I guess is what I have to do most of the time, is how assessing the safety and the risk of what the horse has as its heart disease, and what safety implications does that have, what risks does that pose to you as the rider or the jockey or the driver or the handler of that horse. And so I look at the information, I look at understanding what the job of the horse is intended to do or is doing. So is that something low level at like low speed at on the flat, or is that something at high speed at over obstacles on, you know, difficult ground? Is that where the consequences of having a problem might be greater? You know, if you fall and you hit an obstacle, then that might be much more consequential for you as the rider compared to if you were just in a dressage arena and you can jump off if the horse starts to feel a little bit wobbly. It's certainly important to know who's riding the horse. So we stratify the risk based on the age of the rider. So we definitely are more risk averse when children are riding the horses compared to the adults. We feel like adults have a bit more understanding of risk and assessment of risk, and so they're more able to make their own decisions. Whereas children, we feel like we should probably be advising them of the decisions that we're making, it more than giving them the choice. So who rides the horse can be really important. And also things like, I've worked with para riders and people who maybe physically can't jump off the horse in a you know, certain amount of time. And so it might be difficult for them if they do feel the horse is not right, that they still can't get out of the situation. And so if they were to be collapsed upon, that could be quite serious. I also stratify by the type of heart disease. So, you know, if we're talking about ventricular problems, so that aortic regurgitation is much more concerning to me than the mitral regurgitation, just as far as the risks of the adverse events might be more dangerous. And I'm certainly cognizant of if a dangerous thing has happened before. So if you bring me a horse that you say is having collapsing episodes, I'm very risk averse in those situations compared to a horse that hasn't got a history of that happening. And then of course, you as the riders have different level of risk acceptance. We all know that riding horses is dangerous, inherently dangerous. And so we know that this might increase the risk a little bit, but probably not a whole lot. And so, you know, some people will say to me, I don't want to ride this horse. I'm really nervous. And I'd rather, you know, we retire the horse or we use it in a different way. But I'm not prepared to ride the horse and take the risk. And other people say, well, this is a risky job. I do this for a living. I understand the risk is a little bit higher, but I'm prepared to take that risk. I'm a professional, or, you know, this is something that I am quite comfortable with. And so they might accept a higher level of risk compared to other people. I've definitely had one owner tell me that she wants to die riding her horse. But I did point out that perhaps if your horse collapses, it might not necessarily, you know, be the end of both you and the horse, and you might just be stuck underneath there and seriously injured. So I think that that's something to consider as well, that the level of injury. So we know that when horses collapse, about 30% of the time, the rider is seriously injured. So we definitely want to try and avoid the situation where people are injured. So this is all going into my algorithm in my head, and I'm trying to make the best assessment of what's going on for you and for your horse as far as safety goes. So to finish up, let's go back to a more positive note. So most horses tolerate their heart disease really well and have no signs outwardly that they have a problem in there. But there are a small proportion of horses that do have an increased risk of an adverse event. And it's my job to try and figure out which of those horses it is and try to manage that risk as best as we can. To remember that we need the ultrasound and we need the EKG or ECG to figure out how big the heart is, how good is the function, what's really going on, because hearing the murmur is the first part of the story, but we definitely need more information to be able to assess the risk for you. And I think it's really important also that we can monitor the changes of these problems over time, because sometimes on one day we don't see the whole story. And if we see that horse again in 6 months or 12 months and everything has stayed the same, we can be more confident that it's going to be pretty, you know, slow progression or no progression, and your horse is going to be fine for a much longer period of time. Whereas if we got quite a lot of changes in a small space of time, that might be more concerning and we need to take more care. And so seeing your horse and having them come back and have these recheck exams is really important to understanding how long we have and how that crystal ball is working as far as what's going on in there goes. So with that, I will finish up and see if we have any questions. As far as resources go, these resources here are mostly for veterinarians. So if there's any veterinarians on here who are interested in equine cardiology, you can check out. There's some really great recommendations in our consensus statement that's published here in the Journal of Veterinary Internal Medicine. And there's some little books we've written on understanding ECG analysis, which is a topic for a whole nother day, but also this Vet Clinics of North America is a great edition that's solely on equine cardio and has 13 really great chapters in there for helping you navigate what to do with a horse that has heart disease. But if you've got any questions, I'm always here and very happy to talk about horses' hearts. And I would now finish with a beautiful picture of New Zealand and answer any questions you have. Thanks for listening, guys.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mitchell. This is great. I already have three or four ideas of future talks I'm going to ask you to do, I think. So be prepared for that. I think there's we're getting a lot of thank yous in the chat. We do have a few questions. If you have time to stick around, if anyone wants to stick around, that would be great. Otherwise, you can catch it in the replay. But I'll just start going through them. Is that cool?
Yeah. I was like, oh, right. I was a little bit over time, huh? Oh, dear.
Yeah. That's okay. Yeah. So the first question is, why does the QRS complex face downward?
Excellent question. So that was somebody very observant, I think, probably comparing to the human or the small animal situation. So basically, it's partly how we put the ECG on the horse, and then it's partly how the horse's ventricle takes that electrical information. So mostly the horse has got a little bit of a different conduction system in its ventricle, so different to humans and different to small animal, and that means the way the electrical signal travels is different, and so that gives us the more negative QRS on our ECG.
Thank you. And this is a question about ACE inhibitors. Are horses able to compete when they are on that medication?
It's an excellent question. So it comes down to jurisdictions. So if we're talking FEI level, then it's more difficult. I think they're all probably banned at FEI level from what I remember, but we'd have to double check. At the lower level jurisdictions, I think the USEF, you have to have a signed form saying that you're on the ACE inhibitor, and I think you're not allowed to give it the day of competition, if I remember correctly, but you can certainly give it up to the competition. And then at the low level events where there is no jurisdiction, then it is unregulated, I guess, and so it seems fine. But yeah, I think it's definitely a problem once you hit the higher level. And then as far as racing goes, it's a good question. I don't know many horses that would race on an ACE inhibitor because of their severity of their heart. You know, if you need an ACE inhibitor for your heart disease, it's unlikely, I think, that you could race at maximum performance. So, but I can find out the answer to that question if that person really needs to know.
Thank you. Let's see. One of the attendees here has a 2-year-old halflinger, did not provide disclosure of murmur. Their vet discovered it immediately upon moving him to our location. We don't hear the love dub, just the whoosh, only very loud, so likely a 5-6 grade. What would you expect the prognosis to be?
Yeah, that's a really tricky question. And so the answer to your question is we can't tell. How loud the murmur is doesn't necessarily tell you how bad things are. So we really need the ultrasound to see what's happening and how big the heart is and if the heart's doing fine or if the heart is starting to become enlarged in a 2-year-old horse. And so that's a really hard question just to tell from how loud the murmur is. We really need the ultrasound to see.
That's helpful to know about what else, you know, we could do and we could look at to get more information on that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So the ultrasound tells you what you need to know. It tells you what's leaking. It tells you why it's leaking usually. So is there something that was born with, or is it something that's happened to the valve or whatever? And then it tells you how big the heart is and how well the heart's functioning. And then from there, we can tell, you know, how fast we think it's going to progress, or if we don't think it's going to progress, we can go from there.
And another question is, do we know if heart murmurs are heritable?
It's a good question. I don't think that we have any evidence yet to suggest that. I know that there's some big studies, you know, where they're looking at hundreds or thousands of horses in Europe in particular, but I haven't seen the results of those studies. I mean, you'd need thousands and thousands of horses to know the answer to that question. Mm-hmm. Certainly plenty of horses are bred and go to the breeding barn when they have heart problems. And we don't seem to be overwhelmed, but we just don't have the information yet to know exactly if, you know, there's a hereditable component or not. I think for the most part, we have bred horses for athleticism. And so compared to, like, say, small animals and like French bulldogs or Cavalier King Charles, or, you know, these dogs that don't have to do a ton of athleticism. And so we have, I think, been lucky and to breed away from things that might be more hereditable as far as that goes, heritable, I guess. Yeah.
All right. Well, I think we're going to wrap it up there. We are a little bit over 7 o'clock now. I do want to remind everyone that this was recorded, and we will send you a follow-up email in the days to come with a recording, and then it will also be uploaded to our YouTube playlist. Thank you so much, Dr. Mitchell. We are so glad to have you at Cornell. And this was really, there's lots of thanks in the chat. I hope you can see those too. And then just one more reminder that the Equine Seminar Series is taking a summer break. For those of you watching live, we will be back in the fall with more great talks from our Cornell Equine experts. So I hope everyone has a great summer, and thanks again.
Excellent. Thanks, Sarah.